ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय।
हरे कृष्णा, वेलकम टू भागवत प्रवाह ऑनलाइन कोर्स ऑन द 10th कैंट ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम। सो फार वी कवर्ड द फर्स्ट 39 चैप्टर्स ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम 10th कैंटो, एंड टुडे वी विल बिगिन द 40th चैप्टर। सो इन द प्रीवियस एपिसोड वी हैव सीन हाउ अक्रूर हैज बीन ऑर्डर्ड बाय कंसा टू गो टू वृंदावन एंड ब्रिंग कृष्ण एंड बलराम टू मथुरा, एंड अक्रूर केम एंड ही वॉज टेकिंग कृष्ण एंड बलराम अवे फ्रॉम वृंदावन। एट दैट टाइम all the gopis of Vrindavan were in deep feelings of separation and anguish, and they sang their song of separation called Viraha Geeta throughout the night, and in the morning they have come to physically even stop Krishna and Balaram to go away from Vrindavan, because they were so anxious, they were so fearful that Krishna may not even come back after going to Mathura. So Sukadeva Goswami describes in this chapter, एवं ब्रुवाण विरहातुरा वृषं व्रजस्त्रियः कृष्ण विषक्त मानसाः विसृज्य लज्जां रुरुदुः स्म सुस्वरं गोविंद दामोदर माधवेति। सुखदेव गोस्वामी सेज दैट दिस इनोसेंट गोपीस ऑफ वृंदावन विद देयर माइंड्स कंप्लीटली इमर्स्ड इन लव फॉर कृष्ण, they gave up their shame, they crossed the social barriers, and they came out of their houses and they came on the road to stalk Krishna and Balaram to going away from Vrindavan. They were calling out, they were weeping, they were saying, Krishna Govinda Damodara Madhaveti, please stay back. But Krishna told them that I will come back, so you stay back here, I will come back very soon, please allow me to go, because it is Krishna's responsibility in this manifest incarnation that he has to reduce the burden of the earth. He cannot just stay in Vrindavan only all the while and giving his company to Vrajavasis. He has to go to Mathura and Hastinapur, Dwaraka and many other places and reduce the burden of the earth and reciprocate with so many devotees who are outside Vrindavan also. Of course, in spirit Krishna never goes out of Vrindavan even one step also, but in this external manifestation of this pastime, Krishna is going away from Vrindavan, and that description of Krishna's moving out of Vrindavan and entering Mathura gives us a glimpse of what the gopis' love for Krishna is. So now Akrura started driving the chariot, and then Krishna and Balaram were moving towards Mathura. On the way, Akrura stopped the chariot to do his Sandhya Vandan, to do his rituals and puja. So then he went to the river, and then he has taken bath. And while taking bath, while offering oblations in the river, Akrura had a very divine transcendental vision. And he could see the Supreme Lord Krishna in his form as Lord Narayana sleeping on the bed of Anantasesha. And that Lord Narayana is being glorified by Narada Muni, the four Kumaras, and many other celestial personalities, great sages and devatas. And Akrura was really surprised and astonished with this vision. And Akrura looked back and he saw Krishna and Balaram in the chariot. They were waiting for Akrura to come back from his Sandhya Vandan. And Akrura could see the same lords within the water also. And Akrura was totally mesmerized, and he started offering his heartfelt prayers to the Lord and this divine manifestation within the water. And Akrura glorified the Lord as the creator of the universe, as the maintainer of the universe, as the destroyer of the universe. And Krishna is everything. Krishna is the source and sustenance and foundation of everything that we see in the entire creation. And Krishna is unknown even to Lord Brahma also. Name vidhu suraganaha prabhavam na maharshayaha. Even Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita that it is not easy for common people, even great demigods also, to understand the glories of Krishna. And one can understand the glories of the Lord to some degree, to a considerable extent, only by following the process of bhakti. So thus Akrura highlights the sambandha gnana, means our relationship with the Lord, and abhideya, the process of reviving that relationship, that is bhakti yoga in his prayers. And Akrura also describes the super soul aspect of the Lord and Brahman effulgence of the Lord, and also Akrura surrenders himself to the lotus feet of the Lord. So thus Akrura comes back to the chariot, and then Krishna and Balaram very innocently ask Akrura, "Akrura, what happened? You look very astonished. Did you see something unique or peculiar or surprising in the water? Why are you looking like that?" Then Akrura again offered prayers to Krishna and Balaram, "O Lord, who can understand your leelas? You are here, you are there, you are everywhere." Then Akrura drove the chariot and brought Krishna and Balaram all the way to Mathura. So by the time Krishna and Balaram and Akrura reached Mathura in their chariot, it has already become evening. And along with Akrura, Krishna and Balaram, other chariots were also coming from Vrindavan to Mathura. Nanda Maharaj and many other people also were accompanying Akrura and Krishna and Balaram. But somehow Akrura's chariot reached late because of this Sandhyavandan and his offering of prayers and his vision within the waters. So Nanda Maharaj has already reached this Mathura city. Later Krishna and Balaram reached towards the evening, and Akrura very lovingly, with great devotion, with great humility, he invited Krishna and Balaram to come to his house. Then Krishna said, "My dear Akrura, I will certainly come to your house, but not now. First, I have to complete my duties towards my parents. I have to first kill Kamsa, then release my mother Yashoda, and my mother Devaki, and father Vasudev. So then only I will be able to come to your house." Then Akrura offered prayers to Krishna and then took his leave, and Krishna and Balaram went to their camp. So Nanda Maharaj, Krishna, Balaram and some gopas, they were all given some accommodation. So Krishna went there. So then Krishna and Balaram and all the smaller, younger gopas who accompanied Krishna, Balaram to Mathura, they took permission from Nanda Maharaj. "Nanda Maharaj, first time we are coming to Mathura city, we want to see the city. So let us go. We will go and then see the city." Then Nanda Maharaj said, "Okay, you can go and explore the city, but don't do any mischief there. Don't exhibit your naughty behavior. So you have been behaving the way you want in Vrindavan, because that is our place. So there you can do whatever you want, but this is a city. There are so many soldiers, and Kamsa is a cruel king. So please go visit the place and come back without doing any disturbance there." So Nanda Maharaj gave a caution note to Krishna and Balaram and all the gopas. Then they happily went to tour the city of Mathura. So Krishna left Mathura right on the day of his birth, day of his appearance in Kamsa's prison cell. So after more than a decade, Krishna is coming back now. So now Krishna is very eager to see the city of Mathura. So more than Krishna's excitement to see the city of Mathura, the city of Mathura is so excited to see Krishna. All the residents of Mathura were very happy to see this beautiful form of Krishna who has come back to Mathura after a long time. So all the ladies and all the merchants and brahmanas and the regular citizens of Mathura, they were looking at this magnificent darshan of Krishna as he was walking along with Balaram and all the gopas, seeing the city of Mathura. So Krishna and Balaram enter the city of Mathura, and especially the ladies of Mathura, they see Krishna and they were so enchanted. And so far, all the Mathuravasis have been hearing about the glories of Krishna and the glories of Balaram, because the news from Vrindavan is reaching Mathura, sometimes in a little distracted manner also, but nevertheless they have some idea of what these two boys are. So now they are directly seeing Krishna and Balaram, and they were so excited and they were so happy. What else could be a more joyful experience than seeing Krishna and Balaram directly? So all the ladies became very eager, and Krishna also reciprocated with all these Mathuravasis with his glances and with his smiles, his innocent smiles. And all the residents of Mathura welcomed Krishna and Balaram. So as Krishna and Balaram and all the gopas were touring the city of Mathura, they came upon a washerman. So this is the washerman of Kamsa. So this washerman was carrying so many beautiful, colorful, gorgeous garments with him. And he is also called Rangakara, Rajaka and Rangakara. Means he is a washerman also, and he would dye the clothes also. He would color the clothes also. And he is like a prominent washerman in Mathura city, because he washes the clothes of the king directly, King Kamsa. And he had so many other assistant washermen. And he was surrounded with so many braying donkeys who were carrying all his clothes. So then Krishna, Balaram and all the gopas went to this washerman and asked him, "My dear washerman, can you please give us some clothes? We can see that you are carrying so many colorful clothes. We are boys coming from Vrindavan. So we are very eager to wear this clothes. They are looking very attractive. Can you please give us?" And Krishna promised this washerman, saying that if you give us some clothes, we will bestow you the greatest benefit. You will get the greatest blessings. So now see the fortune of this washerman. The Supreme Lord Krishna is personally coming to this washerman and asking for an offering. Generally, devotees take their offerings and go to the temple of Krishna and offer them. And as soon as their offerings of flowers or fruits or clothes or whatever they brought, they are offered to Krishna, they become happy. And they consider it their great fortune that Krishna has accepted our little offerings. But now, this washerman's fortune is that Krishna is personally coming and asking, "Can you please give us some clothes?" But this washerman was so arrogant. Because of his close connection with King Kamsa, washerman became so proud and so arrogant that he said, "You village boys, you mountain wanderers, you uncivilized villagers, you are forest dwellers, so you are desiring for the clothes of king. These are the clothes of the royal order. Villagers like you cannot wear these clothes. So if you ask like this, the soldiers of the king will beat you, will loot you, will arrest you, will punish you, will even kill you." So in such an arrogant manner, with great pride and anger, this washerman responded to Krishna's humble request. Krishna's request was so humble and polite, but the washerman's response was so provocative and so agitating and so arrogant. So Krishna wanted to teach a lesson to this washerman. So, and washerman was so proud, because of all the washermen, he happens to be the washerman of the king directly. So when we are closely connected to some superiors, then we consider ourselves very special, and we may look down upon those people who may not be having that privilege of close connection with great people. So this is there. Sometimes even devotees are also overwhelmed because of one devotee's close connection with guru or the deities or some superior people. They may tend to look down upon common devotees who may not have that kind of privilege. So this washerman has this kind of arrogance, because he is directly reporting to King Kamsa. So he arrogantly replied like that, and Krishna, just with his fingertips, separated the head of the washerman from his body. And the washerman died. And all the gopas and Krishna and Balaram just picked up their clothes, whatever clothes that they liked, that matched their complexions and their sizes. So they just wore those clothes. So Krishna was looking so resplendent in this new gorgeous clothes, outfits. Actually, this washerman was a washerman in his previous life also. During the pastimes of Lord Ramachandra, this washerman has commented on Lord Ramachandra, saying that Ram is living with Sita Devi, who stayed in someone else's house, means Ravana's house, for almost 1 year. So he commented on Lord Ramachandra like this. Because of that, Lord Ram banished Sita Devi also. He left Sita Devi in the ashram of Valmiki Muni. So that's a very sinful activity to comment, to pass comments on such a chaste woman like Sita Devi. So this washerman again took the birth as a washerman in Mathura city, and now Krishna has liberated this washerman from this life, from this lowly life. So then Krishna moved ahead. So Krishna continued his Mathura tour. So then Krishna came upon a weaver, a person who makes clothes and shawls and cloth ornaments. Then Krishna, when he came there in front of the weaver, the weaver came there with so much of love and devotion. He invited Krishna and he offered Krishna some nice garments and some nice shawl, and also he specifically decorated Krishna with cloth ornaments. Why cloth ornaments? Because Krishna is going for a wrestling match very soon with Chanura Mushtika. So if Krishna wears golden ornaments or silver ornaments and all, it may hurt Krishna's body while fighting. So cloth ornaments are very soft on the body. So this weaver, with great devotion, personally decorated Krishna and Balaram in cloth ornaments. And Krishna was dressed. He took the dress from washerman, and the next is ornaments. He has taken ornaments from the weaver. So Krishna was looking so nice, and Krishna blessed this weaver for his sincere service. Actually, this weaver was a weaver, was a tailor in Mithila in his previous life. In his previous life, he has stitched the garments for Ramachandra and Lakshmana for their marriage. So then Ram and Lakshman wore those dresses. They were looking so nice. And weaver, this tailor, thought that I have stitched these clothes, and Ram and Lakshman were wearing those clothes. They were looking so beautiful. If only I have an opportunity to personally decorate them with my own hands, that would be my greatest fortune. The tailor thought like that. Now the tailor became a weaver in Mathura city, and now he got the opportunity to decorate Ram and Lakshman in the form of Krishna and Balaram personally with these cloth ornaments. So whenever we have a sincere desire to render service to Krishna, Krishna will fulfill that desire sooner or later. So later, Krishna just moved ahead. So while Krishna and Balaram and all the gopas were touring this Mathura city, so many Mathura vasis, the citizens, came out to see Krishna and Balaram. But one person named Sudama, a florist, did not come out to see Krishna and Balaram. He stayed at home only. He was so absorbed in making garlands for Krishna. So Krishna asked, there must be a weaver here. There must be a florist here named Sudama. Where is he? He inquired from the citizens, and Krishna and Balaram personally came to the house of this Sudama. So this Sudama is the weaver. This Sudama is the florist, and he was making garland. And as he was making garland, suddenly he saw Krishna and Balaram standing right in front of him. So Sudama, out of his intense devotion, he immediately wanted to offer obeisances to Krishna and Balaram. But there was not sufficient place in front of him, so he offered half dandavats. And then he lovingly received Krishna and Balaram in his house, and then he offered the best garlands that he has to Krishna, to Balaram, and all the gopas who came to his house also. And although he offered garlands to everyone who came, he kept a very specially made garland for Krishna and offered him secretly. So he has some special devotion for Krishna. So earlier, the weaver offered cloth ornaments to Krishna and Balaram. So that weaver has heard about Krishna's news from Vrindavan many times. And this Sudama florist, he did not just hear about Krishna, he even saw Krishna in Vrindavan. Because under the pretext of collecting some special flowers for his garlands, sometimes this florist would go to Vrindavan also and see Krishna from a corner as a child playing. So he had that experience. Now he is absorbed in making garland. Then Krishna personally came to his house. So So when we are so eager to render service to Krishna, it's not that we have to go to Krishna and offer it. If our devotion is so sincere like this Sudama, Krishna will eagerly come to take that service. So Krishna came and accepted this garland, and Krishna said, "My dear Sudama, oh florist, so I want to give you some blessings. Ask any benediction that you want. So your service is the greatest, it caused a lot of pleasure to me. So please ask whatever you want." And this Sudama, in a very exemplary manner, he asked this. Sopi vavrechalam bhaktim tasmin eva akhilatmani tad bhakteshu cha sauhardam bhuteshu cha dayam param. Sopi vavre achalam bhaktim. Oh Krishna, I want three benedictions from you, not one. Number one is achalam bhaktim. I want unflinching, undeviated devotion unto you. Just I want pure devotion towards you, pure love for you. Then second, tad bhakteshu cha sauhardam. I also want friendship with your devotees. Love for Krishna and friendship with devotees. And third is bhuteshu cha dayam param. I also want to show compassion on common people. Compassion on common people, friendship with devotees, love for Krishna. So these are the three topmost benedictions or aspirations of a pure devotee. And Sudama asked for it, and Krishna very happily bestowed that benediction upon Sudama. And many other benedictions also. Krishna blessed liberation to Sudama. He gave a form that is equivalent to himself. So in the 42nd chapter, we see that Krishna continues his tour. So Krishna went further. So far in his tour, Krishna received beautiful garments from the washerman. He has taken it, all the washerman did not offer. And he also received beautiful ornaments from the weaver. And he received beautiful garlands from the florist Sudama. And now, some sandalwood pulp and some ointments and fragrance is remaining. So Krishna went further and he saw a beautiful woman who had a beautiful face but with a hunchback. So she came, she is a hunchback woman. She was holding some ointments, sandalwood pulp and some other fragrant substances she was holding, very colorful substances. She was going to Kamsa, and Krishna and Balaram came upon this lady and asked, Oh, beautiful woman, Krishna asked this Kubja. She is called Kubja, she is also called Trivakra, because her body is bent in three places. She is a hunchback woman. So her body is bent in three places, but Krishna called her beautiful woman. And Krishna is Tribhanga. His body is curved in three places in a very beautiful manner. But Kubja is called Trivakra. Her body is bent in three places, not in a very beautiful manner, but she was considered very deformed. So Krishna wanted to bless her now. So Krishna asked this woman. She is called Kubja or Trivakra. Actually, she is an expansion of Bhumi Devi. When Kubja is bent like this, in a hunchback form, that actually represents the earth's overburdened condition. So Krishna descended on this planet to relieve the earth from this burden of miscreants and demoniac people, right? So when Krishna is relieving this Kubja from this hunchback, that represents that Krishna is going to reduce the burden of earth also. So Kubja is representing earth in this pastime. And she is also considered an expansion of earth in one sense. So acharyas say like this. And Krishna asked Kubja, "So what are these substances that you are carrying? Who are you?" Then she said that, "My dear Krishna, I am a, my dear young man, you are so handsome." And she was spontaneously attracted to Krishna also. She wanted to serve Krishna. She said that, "I am a maid servant of Kamsa. And Kamsa likes me specifically for the ointments that I make. So the way I make all these cosmetics are very pleasing to Kamsa. So he loves these things. So I am a servant of Kamsa." Then Krishna asked, "Can you give us some ointments?" Then Kubja felt that it's my great fortune that I am able to offer these ointments to this handsome young man. So she took profuse quantities of this sandalwood pulp and other cosmetics and then personally applied on Krishna on the road only, with absolutely no fear of Kamsa. So Everybody is noticing her. It's on the street. It's not in a secluded place. Everybody is able to see that Kubja is offering all the ointments meant for Kamsa to Krishna. But Kubja was so attracted to rendering service to Krishna that she did not have any fear of Kamsa. So when she offered like this profuse quantities, and she also made beautiful patterns on Krishna, the dots are there. So very beautiful paintings on Krishna's face, Krishna's hand, Krishna's chest. So like that she decorated him nicely. So now Krishna's dressing is complete. So Krishna took dresses from the washerman, Krishna took ornaments from the weaver, and Krishna took garlands from the florist Sudama, and now Krishna is taking sandalwood pulp and fragrant substances and cosmetics from Kubja. So Krishna is so pleased with her spontaneous loving service and her fearlessness in serving Krishna. So Krishna wanted to bless her. So Krishna took his left hand and supported her back. Krishna took his two fingers and then kept below her chin and then raised her. And Krishna made her into a very exquisitely beautiful lady, and her hunchback was gone. She was looking so beautiful. And as soon as her body became so beautiful and fit, Kubja immediately wanted to associate with Krishna and please Krishna and serve Krishna. And she immediately proposed to Krishna, "Krishna, I am unable to leave you." So she even caught the cloth of Krishna and said, "Please come to my house." Then Krishna said, "I will certainly come to your house, but not now. I have certain responsibilities to fulfill." So earlier, Akrura also invited Krishna to his house, but Krishna said, "I'll kill Kamsa and come back." Now indirectly, Krishna told Kubja also, "I will come to your house, but not now, later. So you wait. So thank you for inviting me. So you are like a great shelter for all travelers like us. So I will definitely come to your house." Then Kubja became very happy, and Krishna went ahead in his tour. Then Kubja even developed lusty feelings towards Krishna. Actually, this Kubja in her previous life was Surpanakha. Surpanakha was the sister of Ravana. Kubja was the servant of Kamsa. Surpanakha was the sister of Ravana. And when Lord Ramachandra was doing Vanavas, this Surpanakha saw Lord Ram, and she became attracted to Ram, and she said, "Ram, let's marry. So I'm so attracted to you." Then Ram said, "I'm Ekapatni Vrata. I already married Sita Devi. You go to Lakshman." And Lakshman said that, "No, I'm a servant of Lord Ram. If you marry me, you will also become a servant of Sita." So then again, Surpanakha came to Ram. So like that, Surpanakha did not fulfill her desire. Then at one point, Surpanakha wanted to kill Sita Devi so that Ram can accept her. So when Surpanakha was attacking Sita Devi, then Lakshman came and he had cut the nose of Surpanakha. Then Surpanakha, with an uncontrollable desire, although after this incident, Surpanakha called her brothers Khara and Dushana, and 14,000 Rakshasas came to attack Ram, and Ram killed all of them within very short time. And then Surpanakha went all the way to Ravana and reported, and Ravana came in the form of a sage to kidnap Sita Devi also. But whatever, Surpanakha did not fulfill her desire of attaining Ram. So Surpanakha went and performed tapasya for thousands of years to please Lord Shiva. And Shiva came and asked Surpanakha, "Surpanakha, what do you want? Why are you doing so much tapasya?" Then Surpanakha said, "I want Ram as my husband." Then Shiva said, "Your desire we cannot be fulfilled right now because Ram is Ekapatni Vrata, but Krishna will come. So Krishna will fulfill your desire. You will be born in Mathura city and Krishna will fulfill your desire." So now Kubja's desire will be fulfilled. Although Surpanakha had such conjugal attraction towards Krishna, her attraction towards Krishna is not pure like the gopis. While gopis' attraction towards Krishna is pure spiritual love, and there is absolutely no trace of personal enjoyment. They just want to render service to Krishna, and they don't want to enjoy Krishna's company. They want to give enjoyment to Krishna, and thus they derive enjoyment. Their enjoyment is in giving enjoyment to Krishna, but Surpanakha also wanted to enjoy in the association of the Lord. So she had a desire for personal enjoyment also. So Surpanaka's lust, her attraction towards Krishna is not pure like the gopis, but nevertheless, she was attracted to Krishna, no doubt about that. So Krishna blessed her also. So then Krishna and Balaram and all the gopas went ahead in their tour. So they eventually came upon, they actually asked the citizens, where is that Sivadhanu? So you are conducting sacrifice, right? This this Kamsa is conducting a Dhanuryaga. So where is that bow kept? We want to see that bow. Then Krishna and Balaram were directed towards that sacrificial arena where that bow, that magnificent Shiva's bow was displayed. So Krishna and Balaram went there. So the soldiers, they were stopping Krishna and Balaram. They were guarding this bow to protect the bow. But when Krishna went there, the soldiers stopped them. But Krishna and Balaram just threw them away. So they just surpassed the soldiers. And Krishna directly went to the arena, the stage where the bow was kept. And Krishna lifted that bow so effortlessly with his left hand. And then he wanted to string that bow. And while stringing the bow, he pulled the string and the bow broke into two pieces. Just like Lord Ramachandra broke the bow of Lord Shiva and married Sita Devi. Similarly, here also Krishna broke the bow of Lord Shiva. And when the bow was broken, it made such a tumultuous cracking sound that went into all directions, and Kamsa from his palace, he could hear that. So Kamsa heard that sound and he became so overwhelmed with fear. Already Kamsa was so fearful when he heard that Krishna is the eighth child of Devaki, and then he recollected that, oh, this Krishna has lifted Govardhan, he subdued Kaliya, and he killed so many demons like Putana, Trinavarta, Sakatasur, whatever demons I dispatched to find this Devaki's eighth child. All of them were killed by Krishna only, and Kamsa was extremely in fear. Since the day Kamsa heard the Akashavani that Devaki's eighth child is going to kill you, since then he was absorbed in Krishna, in fear. So with a negative feeling. But nevertheless, he was absorbed in Krishna. He was always thinking about Krishna. When will he come? He might kill me at any moment. So he was feeling like that. So when Krishna broke this bow, Kamsa became so perturbed. So he could hear that sound. And the soldiers went and reported to Kamsa. So Kamsa, your bow is broken. The very sacrifice that you are trying to conduct in the name of that Dhanu, Shiva Dhanu, that is broken now. So then when Krishna broke this bow, and Balaramji took one half of the bow, and Krishna took one half of the bow, and some soldiers came to attack Krishna and Balaram when Krishna broke the bow. So Balaramji and Krishna, with this two halves of this dhanu, this bow, the bow, they started beating all the soldiers. They killed some soldiers also. So they began with killing washermen, and now they ended with killing the soldiers who were guarding the Shiva dhanus. So then they came back to their place. So actually, all the citizens of Mathura, they were so astonished to see the activities of Krishna and Balaram. Krishna killed a washerman effortlessly with his fingertips, and Krishna converted that hunchbacked woman, Trivakra, into a very beautiful woman, and Krishna has broken the bow, and Krishna has killed so many soldiers. So all these special, unique activities of Krishna and Balaram astonished the gopis, astonished the Mathuravasis, especially ladies were attracted to Krishna's beauty and activities. So far they have been hearing about Krishna. Now they directly saw Krishna and his activities. So especially the ladies of Mathura, they were so excited to see Krishna and Balaram. And Sukadeva Goswami says, Gopyo Mukunda Vigame Virahaturaya Ashashatasisharita Madhupurya Bhuvan Sampashyatam Purushabhushanagatra Lakshmim Hitvetaranu Bhajatas Chakameyanam Shri. So Sukadeva Goswami, in this context, he was saying, Gopyo Mukunda Vigame Virahaturaya. So actually, in the Viraha Gita, the gopis predicted that the dawn of the next day is very auspicious for the women of Mathura, and it is very inauspicious for us, because Krishna was going from Vrindavan to Mathura. So the gopis were thinking that Mathura women would be very fortunate, but we are so unfortunate. So the next morning would be very auspicious for Mathura women. So now, according to the prediction of the gopis, the Mathura women are able to see Krishna and Balaram now. So this is because of the blessings of the gopis of Vrindavan, that Mathura vasis are able to see Krishna now. So actually, Sukadeva Goswami was constantly remembering the gopis. Although Krishna came to Mathura and Sukadeva Goswami is describing Krishna's Mathura pastimes, Sukadeva Goswami, while narrating these pastimes, he was still recollecting the gopis of Vrindavan. Every now and then, he recollects the gopis' memories. So Sukadeva Goswami was also on the side of gopis. He was also not very happy that Krishna left the gopis in Vrindavan and he came to Mathura. Actually, although the gopis' feelings of separation and gopis' anguish was described so elaborately by Sukadeva Goswami, Acharya say that Krishna also was not very happy to leave Vrindavan and come to Mathura. Krishna, although apparently he is excited to see Mathura city, when he is seeing all the women in Mathura, he was searching for those faces that resemble the gopis of Vrindavan. So Krishna left Vrindavan, but he left his heart in Vrindavan only. So Krishna was constantly remembering gopis and he secretly wept. He cried incessantly in separation from the gopis of Vrindavan. So Krishna is also feeling that separation, but for our sake, but for the sake of reducing the burden of the earth and killing the miscreants, Krishna took out his time and he came to Mathura and he started killing Kamsa, Kovalyapid and all the miscreants who were supporting Kamsa. And in future he would be killing so many other people like Jarasandha's army and Kala Yavana and all these people. So now Krishna came back to his camp. Then that night Krishna and Balaram ate the rice mixed with milk and sugar packed by Mother Yashoda in Vrindavan, and they happily slept. They were very happy, but two people could not sleep that night properly. One is Kamsa, second is Nanda Maharaj. Kamsa could not sleep well in that night because Kamsa has heard all about all the glorious activities and courageous activities done by Krishna, and Kamsa was thinking that tomorrow is the last day of my life or what. He was very anxious, and Kamsa was seeing so many inauspicious omens. So Kamsa would go in front of a mirror and he would see his body in the mirror, but he cannot see his face. Or sometimes Kamsa sees his shadow and he can see a hole in the shadow. So like that, Kamsa saw so many bad omens. He envisioned that although he was unable to sleep, he had dreams, he had visions. So he envisioned that he was smeared with oil and he was sitting on a donkey and so many other inauspicious omens Kamsa was seeing, and he could not sleep whole night. He was very anxious that Krishna might kill him. And Nanda Maharaj could not sleep that night because Nanda Maharaj was anxious about the safety of Krishna and Balaram. Oh, I told these boys not to do any mischief. Now this Krishna killed Kamsa's washerman and killed Kamsa's soldiers, and even he has broken the bow of Lord Shiva. So what will happen now? Will Kamsa punish these boys? So Nanda Maharaj was very anxious, so he could not sleep. So that completes the 42nd chapter. Now we will enter the 43rd chapter. In the 43rd chapter, Sukadeva Goswami describes the next day morning. So next day morning, Krishna, Balaram and all the Gopas and Nanda Maharaj, everyone got up, and Krishna wanted, Krishna asked Nanda Maharaj, we will go to Yamuna and then we will go to Yamuna Ghat and take bath there. So then Nanda Maharaj said, okay, fine, you can go, but come fast to the wrestling arena of Kamsa. So now the next program is there. We are supposed to go to the wrestling arena of Kamsa. So then Krishna said, okay, we'll join you. You go ahead. Then Krishna went there and then he he was coming towards the wrestling arena. He asked a few people, where is the Kamsa's wrestling arena? Where is that ring? Then they directed him, and Krishna, Balaram and the Gopas came there. While they were coming to the wrestling ring, on the way, this big elephant named Kuvalaya Pida was blocking the entrance of Krishna. And Krishna said, Krishna told the person who is riding the elephant, he is called Mahamatra. Oh, Mahamatra, you drive away this elephant. I want to move ahead. So your elephant is blocking my way. Just take him aside. Otherwise, I will just send you to hell, send you to Yamaraj's abode. Then this Mahamatra was instructed by Kamsa specifically to block the entrance of Krishna and finish Krishna there only before he even enters the wrestling ring. So Kamsa was actually not the son of Ugrasena. Once Narada Muni told Kamsa that, Kamsa, you are not born of Ugrasena. So your father was away from your mother for some time. Means Ugrasena was away from your mother. At that time, a demon named Drumila disguised himself in the form of Ugrasena and then associated with Ugrasena's wife, and thus Kamsa was born. So Kamsa was the son of Drumila. So Kamsa came to know about this incident. So Kamsa revealed this incident to Mahamatra and told, you are my dear elephant keeper. So please help me in killing Krishna. So then Mahamatra reassured Kamsa, no problem, don't worry. I will make sure that Krishna is killed before coming to the wrestling arena only. Very confidently he reassured Kamsa, and now he is trying to block Krishna's entrance, Krishna's way. And now Krishna started fighting with Kuvalaya Pida. First he started playing with Kuvalaya Pida. He agitated Kuvalaya Pida, and then he started hiding behind the legs of Kuvalaya Pida only. So Kuvalaya Pida was such a huge elephant, and Krishna is a small boy. So when Krishna is standing or hiding between the legs of Kuvalaya Pida, Kuvalaya Pida could not figure out where is he. Then eventually Krishna fought with Kuvalaya Pida and then killed Kuvalaya Pida within just few minutes only. Then the blood of Kuvalaya Pida just came upon Krishna and Balaram. And Krishna and Balaram took the tusks of Kuvalaya Pida, the white tusks of Kuvalaya Pida, and then put on their shoulders and entered the wrestling ring. So this Kuvalaya Pida was a very powerful elephant. Actually, this Kuvalaya Pida belongs to Jarasandha. So this Kuvalaya Pida elephant was in Jarasandha's camp. And once Kamsa went outside, and this elephant came and started doing some disturbance there, and Kamsa got disturbed. He was agitated. He just picked up this Kuvalaya Pida, who was actually having the strength of hundreds of elephants. So he just picked up this Kuvalaya Pida and then threw him 80 miles away. Then Jarasandha understood, this Kuvalaya Pida is such a powerful elephant. Who is that strong warrior that he could pick up this Kuvalaya Pida and then throw him away so effortlessly? Then people came, and then somebody informed him that it is Kamsa. Then Jarasandha was so impressed with Kamsa's power that he wanted to make Kamsa as his own son-in-law. So he offered his two daughters Asti and Prapti to Kamsa in marriage, and Kamsa married like that. So Kuvalaya Pida was instrumental in Kamsa's marriage. And as a marriage gift, Jarasandha also gave Kuvalaya Pida to Kamsa. And that Kuvalaya Pida is killed by Krishna now. And Krishna killed Kuvalaya Pida and entered the wrestling arena. So in this context, there is a beautiful shloka that Sukadeva Goswami speaks. Basically, this shloka describes how different people in Kamsa's wrestling arena perceived Krishna according to their own personal mood. Malla nama shanirndranam naravaram strinam smaro murtiman gopanam svajano satam kshitibhujam shasta svapitro shishum mrityar bhojapater virada vidusham tattvam param yoginam Vrishninam paradevateti vidito rangam gataha sagraja. Mallanam ashanir. Malla means all these wrestlers like Chanura, Mushtika, Shala, Toshala, Kuta. These are all big mountain-like wrestlers. For them, Krishna looked like a thunderbolt, because thunderbolt or Vajrayudha of Indra is known to smash mountains. Mallanam ashanir. Dranam Naravaram, all the general men saw Krishna as the best of all males. Strinam Smaro Murtiman, they also saw Krishna, the ladies in that wrestling ring, they saw Krishna as personification of Cupid, third category. Vallanam Ashanir, Dranam Naravaram, Strinam Smaro Murtiman. Gopanam Svajano, the Gopas, they saw Krishna as their own Svajana, our own man, our own person, our friend, our relative. So, Gopanam Svajano, Asatam Kshiti Bhujam Shasta. Asatam Kshiti Bhuja means bad kings. Kshiti means earth. Kshiti Bhuja means the kings who are ruling the earth. Kshiti Bhujam Asatam means bad kings who are ruling the earth. Desa Krishna Shasta, the punisher. So, Shastam Swapitro. So, the next is Swapitro Sishuhu, sixth item. So, Swapitro Sishu means Krishna's parents saw Krishna as their own dear child in Vatsalya Rasa. Then Mrityur Bhojapater, Mrityu, this Bhojapati Kamsa, he saw Krishna as death personified, Mrityur Bhojapater. Then Virad Avidusham, Avidusham means unintelligent people, they saw Krishna as Virat Trupa in Bhivatsarasa. Virad Avidusham, Tattvam Param Yoginam, and great yogis saw Krishna as Param Tattva, absolute truth. Then 10th item, 10th category of people are Vrishninam Paradevateti Vidito. The Vrishnis saw Krishna as their supremely worshipable deity. So, each of these 10 categories of people saw Krishna in 10 different ways. That's why Krishna is called Akhila Rasamrita Murti. Vrishninam Paradevateti Vidito Rangam Gataha Sagrajaha Sagrajaha. So, as 10 categories of people in 10 rasas are seeing Krishna in 10 different ways, Krishna made his entrance into this Ranga, this wrestling arena of Kamsa, along with his Agraja, means his elder brother Balaram. So, these people are in different rasas. Some are in Vatsalya rasa, some are in Sakhya rasa, some are in Dasya rasa, some are like positive rasas, some are primary rasas, some are like negative. Some people have negative attitude towards Krishna. So they are into seeing Krishna in Bibhatsarasa or Bhayanakarasa. So the Jugupsa, all this will, Sthayi Bhava will just manifest. This is a very elaborate shloka that could be discussed for a long time. So, but this is a quick summary. And then Krishna entered this wrestling arena. Then Mathuravasis saw Krishna and Balaram. They are very small, tender boys. And the Mathuravasis felt so compassionate on these boys because a wrestling match is about to start. So Krishna and Balaram are hardly 10-11 year old boys, and these mountain like wrestlers are there, Chanura, Mushtika, Shala, Toshala, Kuta. They are about to fight with Krishna and Balaram, and all the Mathuravasis, especially the ladies of Mathura, who have a very tender and compassionate and soft heart, they felt so concerned about Krishna and Balaram. They thought that this is not a right match. So people who are watching this match, they don't know the principles of dharma. They are actually allowing adharma to happen. Actually, fight can happen between two equals. But Krishna and Balaram are tender boys, and these people are very experienced mountain-like wrestlers. How can there be a match between these two people? So there is absolutely no match. And other people who are like great ministers and learned people, they are watching this adharma, watching this show, watching this adharma to happen here. So we are not supposed to support these people like this. So they started conversing. That completes the 43rd chapter. We enter the 44th chapter. So in this 44th chapter, the wrestling is described. So Krishna and Balaram, they started fighting with Chanura and Mushtika. So Krishna fought with Chanura and Balaram fought with Mushtika. Actually, there was a nice conversation between Chanura, Mushtika and Krishna also. That Chanura asks Krishna, that Krishna, let's wrestle. Then Krishna says, no, we cannot wrestle with you. We are young boys. You are such big experienced wrestlers. How can we both fight with each other? It's not proper. Then Chanura says that, no, you are not a young boy. Yeah, you are young boy, but you are very powerful. You killed so many demons in Vrindavan. And just now you killed Kovalaya Pida and came here. Then Krishna just apparently showed some humility and said that actually I did not kill all of them. They are like old people, like Arishtasura was an old bull, Dhenuka is an old donkey. So we did not kill actually. And now Kovalayapeda, the recent thing that you are speaking about, Kovalayapeda tried to attack me. And out of fear, I ran away from Kovalayapeda. And when Kovalayapeda was trying to catch me, Kovalayapeda was trying to catch me, and his tusks just went into the earth, and Kovalayapeda attempted to remove his tusks from the earth. At that time, the tusks were broken and Kovalayapeda died, and we picked up those tusks and then we came here. I did not kill Kovalayapeda. Like that, Krishna started speaking very cleverly in front of Chanura and Mushtik. And then Chanura said, Krishna, don't speak cleverly. You are not an ordinary person. You have killed so many people. When you are fighting with us, there is absolutely no mismatch there or no injustice there. And on top of it, we are all being ruled by the king. It is king's desire, it is King Kamsa's desire that we both fight with each other. So, as citizens, we are supposed to fulfill the orders and desires of the king. So, let's fight. Then Krishna said, okay, fine, let's fight because you want us to fight. So, don't blame if you die. Internally, Krishna was thinking like that, and then he started fighting with Chanura, and then Balaramji started fighting with Mushtika. So it's a very long fight, and as initially Krishna did not show his full prowess, so Krishna was allowing Chanura and Mushtika to fight with him, and he was kind of encouraging them in fighting also. So while this fight was going on, all the ladies of Mathura, they became extremely concerned that this is such a great injustice. See that beautiful boy Krishna's face, it's already filled with a lot of perspiration, and the drops of blood are there on his face because he just killed Kovalayapeda. And now this Chanura is trying to attack Krishna. What will happen to Krishna? Like that, these people, these women of Mathura, they were so concerned about Krishna, and they suddenly remembered the fortune of the gopis of Vrindavan. All the Vrajavasis are so fortunate. The gopis of Vrindavan are so fortunate because they are able to see Krishna's beautiful face, and they are able to see Krishna in great happiness in Vrindavan while he is served by all Vrajavasis. But we are so unfortunate that we are seeing Krishna being attacked by these wrestlers. So it's our misfortune to see Krishna in such a piteous condition, and it's their fortune to see Krishna in such a pleasurable situation. So Krishna is happy in Vrindavan, but as soon as Krishna came to Mathura, Krishna is being attacked by these huge wrestlers. The Mathura women became very concerned about it, and they remembered Vrindavan and how what Krishna used to do in Vrindavan. They say, Punyabhata Vraja Bhuvo Yadanan Yadayam Drilinga Gudha Purana Purusho Vanachitra Malyaha Gahpalayan Sahabalaha Kanakwanayam Chavenuhu Vikrida Yanchati Giritra Ramarchitangharam. So in Vrindavan, Krishna is walking barefoot on the land of Vrindavan along with all the gopas, and the gopis are lovingly glancing at him. The gopas and gopis are lovingly serving him. And Krishna is so happy in Vrindavan. Gudaha Purana Purusho Vanachitra Malyaihi. Krishna is decorated with beautiful garlands made of forest flowers. And he is Purana Purusha. Although he is the primeval Lord, the source of everything that exists in the entire creation, he took the form of a human being and became a cowherd boy, and he started tending cows in Vrindavan. And later they remember the fortune of the gopis of Vrindavan. So what great austerities did the gopis do? The Mathura woman said that there is a beautiful shloka that says that Gopyastapa kimacharan yadamushya rupam lavanya saramasamor dhamananya siddham drigbhih pibantyanu savabhinavam durapam Ekanta dhama yashasha hashriya aishwarasya. In this shloka, the woman of Mathura described the great fortune of the gopis who were able to see six aspects of Krishna's beauty in Vrindavan. Gopyah tapah kimacharan yada mushya rupam. What great austerities did the gopis perform to be able to see Krishna in Vrindavan, who is endowed with six aspects of beauty? So actually, austerities are not qualification to see Krishna in Vrindavan. It's a conventional way of seeing that. When the Mathura woman said that what austerities did the gopis do, that does not mean that austerities are qualification to see Krishna in Vrindavan. It's a conventional way of saying it. So, Gopyah tapah kimacharan yadamushya rupam. And what is the speciality of Krishna's form? Number one, Lavanya saram means Krishna's form is the essence of all loveliness. Lavanya saram. Second, Asamordham. There is no other form or beauty superior or equal to Krishna. Asamordham. Third, Ananya siddham. Where did Krishna get this beauty? It's innate in him. He did not acquire this beauty from somewhere. Ananya siddham. Fourth, Drigbhi pivanti anusava. Abhinavam durapam. So fourth is, although you drink the nectar of Krishna's beauty regularly, still you feel like seeing Krishna again and again, drinking that beauty again and again. Trigbhi pivanti anusava abhinavam. It appears newer and newer. Then fifth, durapam. It's very rare to see Krishna in Vrindavan. Then sixth is, ekanta dhama yashashah shriya aishwarasya. That beautiful form of Krishna is the one and only abode of all opulences, including strength and beauty and fame and knowledge, renunciation, etc. So that's the speciality of Krishna's form in Vrindavan. And gopis can see that form while the Mathura women are seeing Krishna being tormented by these wrestlers. So in the next sloka, the Mathura Vasis glorify the fortune of gopis who are constantly absorbed in Krishna's remembrance.
यादो हने वहनने मथनोपलेपा प्रेंकांखनार्भरुदितो क्षणमार्जनादो गायन्ति चैन मनुरक्त धियोश्रुकंठ्यो धन्याव्रजस्त्रिय उरुक्रमचित्तयानः.
यादो हने वेल मिल्किंग द काउस, वहनने वेल थ्रेशिंग ग्रेन्स, मथन वेल चर्निंग बटर मिल्क, उपलेप वेल स्मीरिंग their walls with cow dung, prinkankhana while swinging on swings, ukshana while sprinkling water mixed with cow dung in their courtyards, arbharudita while taking care of their crying babies, marjanado while sweeping their floors. All the gopis are constantly singing the glories of Krishna. Gayanti chaina manurakta dhiyoshru kanthyo. So with faltering voices, they were always singing the glories of Krishna. Dhanya vrajastriya urukrama chittayanaha. The gopis are so fortunate because their minds are totally immersed in thoughts of Krishna, in remembrance of Krishna constantly. But we are so unfortunate. We are seeing Krishna being troubled by these wrestlers. So seeing the loving descriptions and concerns of all the Mathura women, Krishna wanted to relieve them of that suffering. So Krishna increased his strength and he fought with Chanura and Mushtika very valiantly, and Krishna eventually killed Chanura and Balaramji killed Mushtika, and three other wrestlers came. They are Shala, Toshala, Kuta, and Krishna and Balaram together killed these three fellows also. Then Kamsa became so mad, so crazy, he just stood up on his dais because all his plans are smashed. First he dispatched Keshi and Keshi was killed. Then he arranged Kuvalayapida. Kuvalayapida was killed. Then Chanura, Mushtika, Shala, Toshala, Kota, all these five people are also killed in the hands of Krishna and Balaram. Now Kamsa had absolutely no one else with him. He himself was there. So Kamsa just got up from his seat and then he shouted at the top of his voice, "Arrest Nanda Maharaj. Arrest that fool Vasudev. Kill my father Ugrasena. Arrest all the cowherd men." So like that, when Kamsa was crazily speaking like this, Krishna jumped from the wrestling ring onto the dais of Kamsa. And Kamsa picked up his sword and shield and tried to attack Krishna. And Krishna just caught Kamsa and threw him on the wrestling belt. So just with that force only, Krishna, that Kamsa almost became lifeless. And Krishna just jumped onto the body of Kamsa and started beating Kamsa with his fists and he dragged the dead body of Kamsa in front of everyone so that everyone understands that this fellow has already died. So then in this way Krishna effortlessly killed Kamsa. And Kamsa, because he was so absorbed in Krishna with fear all these years, so Kamsa was liberated by Krishna. So after that, Kamsa's eight brothers came, and Krishna and Balram, they killed these eight brothers also. Then Kamsa's wife cried, and after that, this Vasudeva and Devaki came to Krishna, and instead of coming and embracing Krishna lovingly, because they were seeing Krishna after more than a decade, they saw Krishna on his birthday in Kamsa's prison cell. Now they are so happy that they saw Krishna, but they did not immediately embrace Krishna. They went into some overwhelming reverential feelings towards Krishna. They folded their hands. They were offering prayers to Krishna. They were sitting in front of Krishna with respect. Krishna did not like this. I am meeting my parents after such a long time and they are offering dandavats to me instead of showing their affection towards me. So Krishna did some magic with his energy. Then Devaki and Vasudeva were overwhelmed with feelings of Vatsalya Rasa and they embraced Krishna and Balaram. So then Krishna established Ugrasena as the king of Mathura, and later Vasudev arranged for Krishna and Balaram's education under the guidance of Sandipani Muni. So Vasudev arranged for their second birth ceremony, because they were Kshatriya children. So he arranged for a second birth ceremony, and then he sent them to Sandipani Muni's ashram. And in Sandipani Muni's ashram, Krishna and Balaram were like exemplary students. And Krishna learned all the Vedas and Upanishads and 64 kinds of arts in 64 days. That's why he is called Chatushashti Kalaprapurna. And after that, as a Guru Dakshina, Krishna and Balaram retrieved the dead son of Sandipani Muni and then gave him back to Sandipani Muni. And in this way, Krishna and Balaram received the blessings of Sandipani Muni, their guru. So Krishna showed to everyone that a guru is very important for our education and for our spiritual life also. So he was so obedient to Sandipani Muni. So that completed the 45th chapter. So today we discussed Krishna's entrance into Mathura and how Krishna delivered that washerman, then weaver and florist Sudama and Kubja, and later he killed Kuvalaya Pida, then he killed Chanura, Mushtika, Shala, Toshala, Kuta along with Balaram, and he killed Kamsa, and he released his parents from the imprisonment of Kamsa, and he took education from Sandipani Muni and revived the dead son of Sandipani Muni also. So tomorrow we will begin the next chapter, 46th chapter, the Uddhavas episode. So thank you all very much. ग्रंथराज श्रीमद् भागवतम की जय. श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय. हरे कृष्ण.